Good morning to all. Welcome to this session. Today we have Dr. Balasubramania S. as our speaker. He is a senior consultant, Karnataka Innovation and Technology Society, which is called KTEC, Department of IT, BTIS&T, Government of Karnataka. He received his PhD from Bangalore University. He is a well experienced and is a demonstrated skill of working in the industry, academic, and government administration. He is a very strong administrator, has very strong professional administrative skills in biotechnology, management, research, and development in life. Sir, on behalf of the staff, students, and management of the Oxford College of Engineering, we are very delighted to have you as our guest speaker for today. So we welcome you to our event. So you may please take over the session now.
Yeah. Thank you very much for the invitation. It is my pleasure to join you all in the good morning. I don't know how many of you are from Karnataka, but my talk is mostly restricted to Karnataka. But after the talk, if the audience wants to hear about other programs and schemes of central government, probably I can touch a little on that. But since I am representing Government of Karnataka, I am just restricting myself to the activities what you do within the Karnataka. But we, Bangalore and Karnataka as a global hub, but we do interact with lot many agencies, both international and national. So I just highlight few of the aspects. And basically, what I am trying to give you across is basically a bird's eye view of what activities what you are doing, and how as a whole. It is enriching their biotechnology ecosystem in the state. That is the basic the background of the talk what I'm going to give you. I'll just take to my presentation, then it will be easy for you to. Hope you are able to see my screen.
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Yeah. You all know Karnataka is one of the leading state in many aspects, be it education, be it technology, and be it in terms of adapting some of the new ideas. So Karnataka has always been the forefront. And we consider Karnataka as a global innovation hub, because I'll tell you the reason why we're calling this a global innovation hub in the following slides. Just to, I don't know how far people in Karnataka, as I told you, are from Karnataka, but to give a outline, so we have many infrastructure, many specialities of the state, which is very unique to India as well as the world. So in terms of having, with a coastline, we have 300 kilometers of coastline, and you have ports, we have Western Ghats to give the kind of bioresources what you're talking. So basically speaking, Karnataka is something which the industry what we're talking basically in Karnataka is ITIS, that is, we're talking service industry, then biotechnology, engineering, electronics, telecom. So these are the major industries that is thriving in the state of Karnataka. And we have a lot of infrastructure which is making people to come here and set up their industry. As you all know, Bangalore has many sobriquets, and being garden city, all those things is now a passe. We understand is very important, but at the same time, we know it is one of the fastest growing city. It is most dynamic city. It is most technologically technology hub, what we call, and it is one of the more number of education institutions are there. Things adding to it, and it's till recently, even in office space also, it is one of the city where a lot of office space has been, more number of office space has been booked by the industry and other companies. So keeping that point of view, Bangalore is like something like engine of the whole Karnataka. And I know it is very important for a city to develop, but at the same time, every city has own limitations. So what we're trying to do basically in recent years is to see whether we can have the similar kind of development in other cities of Karnataka, be it Hubli, Dharwad, Mangalore, Mysore, all those things. So recently we have come with a policy called Beyond Bangalore policy. So where we are trying to see whether some of the activities can be pushed across to these cities, at the same time incentivize the companies and other people who want to set up industry or prepare, I mean have some kind of activity that, or Bangalore based companies or Bangalore based organizations which want to extend it to beyond Bangalore. So keeping that point of view, you know, so Bangalore is, you know, I mean, way back in 1960s, the first prime minister has told already that Bangalore is something like, Bangalore is the city of future. So now we have kept the same thing into our, I mean, we are continuing the tradition. And I hope in future also we'll be doing it with the support of people like what we're talking, like industry, academia, and the government together, what interaction. So my highlight of this program is basically to bring the gist of what as a government interact, how they're interacting with industry as well as academia to keep the engine of the growth going in the state. That is the basic idea of what I'm trying to put across. And many of you, I know most of you are faculty, and you will be more interested in critical aspects and technology aspects of it. But at the same time, it's very important for you to know about what state has a policy, as a growth, how they're planning. At the same time, you also need to contribute in terms of providing inputs from the grassroots level, like what exactly you would like to put across so that the state can, I mean, say the information what we get from people like you, be it industry, academia, or other organization, we can take into consideration and plan ourselves. So this is what we basically want to convey to this talk. And you, as I told you, we are Karnataka is one of the number one state in innovation. So we have one of the third, almost top 10 startup ecosystem in the world. And we have more than 350 global research centers here. And almost 400 plus out of the 500 Fortune, they have one or the other form of activity they are doing here. And you know, Bangalore, Karnataka is a biotech hub of India and to the world also. And as I told you, we have the highest office space absorption in Asia Pacific. You know, you must be seeing in how much the ring road area, all the and the new airport area, how the new kind of offices are coming up. And the more importantly, our demographic advantage, what we have is we have very young population. You can see that we have the average around 37% of the population is between 15 to 37. So you can understand the kind of energy and the enthusiasm, what will be there like, I mean, it'll be there outside and which we want to tap. At the same time, you can see that the number of trained manpower or professionals, what we have, more than 20,000. I mean, you know, in IT industry itself, we have more than 3 lakh, 4 lakh people working. At the same time, we have a number of PhDs. I mean, again, Bangalore, Karnataka is known for its aerospace, and we have more than 10,000 aeronautical engineers. So these all giving a kind of ecosystem what any industry or any academia or anybody who wants to have a growth, both in terms of investment as well as bringing out new ideas. So these all matters. Probably you may be wondering why a biotechnology session, we are talking about something else. The idea is that biotechnology cannot grow in isolation and it needs a lot of other support system. And at the same time, you need to have a cross-disciplinary application. You must be knowing now Perseverance, the rover, what has gone. It is doing astrobiology. Astrobiological experiments will be carrying out. So you need to have engineering support system there, and at the same time you need to have biotechnology or bio support systems. So when both of them come together, we can make the world of difference there. And again, we are again in the latest technologies, whether it is in artificial intelligence, whether it is blockchain. So we are well forward in that area also. And more importantly, as I told you, Bangalore has become a cosmopolitan, and more because of the number of companies what we have who are drawn towards the talent pool what we have. You must be knowing that Tesla has taken an office space here, and they're going to set up an office here. And earlier we have Google, Boeing, Intel, Shell, all those people are there. And apart from that, we have other companies like automobile companies like Toyota, Honda, I mean, few other companies, what you can see, Hitachi, all those people. So you can see most of the people who are looking at talent, who are looking at an R&D kind of talent, they're definitely coming to Bangalore. And we are in the process of helping out in terms of, recently we have come out with what is known as, I won't touch that. Basically, we have come out with what is known as eR&D policy, where we are providing a lot of incentives for the companies as well as academic institutions to take up R&D work, leading to having a lot of patents, so that slowly our R&D capacity can be expanded to a manufacturing capacity, which is the ultimate goal of the whole policy or whole aspects what you're trying to do. And again, coming to business, I know again you'll be wondering why we're talking about business. See, the thing is, like, it's very important because, you know, when you teach your students, when you guide them across, it is not always about technology. It is about the environment where they are located and how they want to develop their career. It may be in terms of becoming an entrepreneur and they want to know certain things. So they need to understand that there are means and ways for if somebody to form a company and somebody to grow in terms of business, and how the state government as well as the central government together are providing a lot of benefit to them, or making the what is known as ease of doing business. You must be hearing this a lot in recent times. Starting from Honorable Prime Minister to Chief Minister, everybody will be talking about ease of doing business, because primarily we have been little regulatory, or we can say more of inspection raj, what we used to call earlier. Prior to 1991, you know, most of us may not be aware, but a lot of industry, for industry to grow, a lot of inspections were there, a lot of compliances was there. Now we are slowly opening up ourselves. And we are making the life of a businessman much easier. We are making many of the things online, and we are making the compliance also a little liberal, so that the very foundation of any business is to create wealth. So in the process, we should not be burdened with something else which is hampering the very aspect of the core aspect of the business, what we call. So keeping that point of view, a lot of efforts are going to make the ease of doing business in Karnataka, apart from what central government also is doing. So we have single window agencies where you can apply online. Somebody can apply online and they'll be handhold till the project comes into the field. So we say it can be greenfield or it can be brownfield projects like that. And we have, apart from that, what we do is basically we have some of the we have some systems wherein we get feedback from the industry as well as academia and as well as other organizations or like industry bodies, where we all incorporate in all our aspects. So we have a lot of incentives and fiscal incentives and concessions will be provided to them. You can see that we have been mentioning that there's been no record of any major union management clash in Karnataka's history. So this is very important. And you may be thinking that why this is important. Because this is important because industry works when you have a management as well as an employer. They work in a coordination. You can get a good business happening there, or the production can happening there. So the state government's role plays a very important role. I just want to tell you that recently, you know, that the Toyota factory in Tumkur, they have some problem, Bidadi. But state government is trying to help them to reach out to some kind of consensus among themselves. And they're playing like a good friend there. At the same time, you must be knowing about Vistron, what happened. There also, we are trying to see that both of them are not in, they are happy with the way they are. So now, these all aspects are important. Because I just want to talk about all these things, because it is not just about now it is not just about technology. It is technology is very important. It's needed, but at the same time we need to know about the business aspect, because basically business is a risk mitigation. How much ever mitigation of the risk you do, that much growth is possible in a business. That's a basic idea. So again, we are recently, as I told you, we have come with many things, and one of the major things is that, especially related to RAM, I mean, obviously we are doing a lot with the employment and commercial establishment can have 24 hours working hours based on the industry again. We are given liberation for that. And coming to land reforms is very important, because see, earlier anybody cannot buy agricultural land. non-agriculturist, what we call. So now it is liberalized, and you, any non-agriculturist also can buy agriculture land. If somebody is interested to set up or buy agriculture land, venture into a kind of agri activities, he definitely can do it. At the same time, we have allowed industry also to buy agriculture land directly from the farmers, and they develop it in a joint or in another manner. So these all matters for anybody to. As I told you, because in future it is more of employment. It's the kind of what we see basically in terms of government jobs. All this is going to come up, and you know, weirdly, that is what contractual kind of economy is going to be. And almost by 2030, we are expecting around 35 to 40% of the workforce will be working in terms of a contractual basis, where it will be like 5 years, 6 years contract, or it will be project basis. So these are going to be the norm. So if we can pass on this information to students, probably they'll be able to appreciate and plan themselves and their career also, and especially create a job. And I'm starting from this is basically a background about Karnataka. I hope I have given a small gist. More information is available in other places, and a lot of other people will be talking. But I just thought I'll touch upon these just to give a brief about what is the state of industry in Karnataka, or the outlook ecosystem, what is there. And coming to Karnataka, you know, as you know, we consider as the next local innovation hub. We are trying to collaborate with the other innovation hubs like Boston, Silicon Valley. Now, all those places we are working on, and at the same time, we are nurturing the ecosystem here. So how we do? So you can see that Karnataka has almost 25 to 30% of the the total turnover in the country. We are catering to it, and we have 9% of the total turnover, revenue what is generated. So we 9% of it, we come under Asia, and globally we are minuscule. Right now it's 2%. We hope to grow much more.
One second. Yeah, I understand. So we're not able to hear you.
Companies in Karnataka, Bangalore and Karnataka. And as I told you, we have a 35% market share. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Please proceed.
Just to give a brief about our organization, how it works, our government department. See, basically, we come under Department of Electronics, Information Technology, Biotechnology, and Science and Technology. This is a department under, it comes in the state government. So we have a minister, Dr. C.N. Ashwath Narayan is the deputy CM and minister for this department. And we have a what is known as additional chief secretary or principal secretary, who is a senior IAS officer, who will be head of this department. And under the ACS or principal secretary, there will be a director. She or he will be mid-level or another senior IAS officer. And our structure is that, you know, this comes under department, but we come under what is known as Karnataka Innovation and Technology Society. It's a society or what we call as a nodal agency for implementing programs and schemes of the department. So for many reasons, we have either boards or societies or trust under the department, basically to make sure that we have the flexibility and reach out to the people and implement all the programs. So in the department, in the KITS, what we call our Karnataka Innovation and Technology Society, we have biotechnology facilitation cell. This is a cell wherein we regularly interact with industry, academia, and other organizations. And we bring the government also, being part of the government. And we get a lot of feedback, and we provide a lot of inputs to the government, be it in terms of coming to the policy, be it in terms of coming to the programs. So we provide all the information. So we have a very small team here, a four-member team, supported by obviously our senior officers who guide us in terms of how the government system works. So we, as the outside experts, we provide a lot of inputs to them, taking cue from the what is happening in the industry. This is the structure. Now, why I'm telling this? Because basically, you need to understand or convey the message to the students when you teach across and when you approach people. Because at, you know, at the government level, you have various steps for you to reach out. For small things, sometimes people write to the senior officers and probably they will not take into consideration. And sometimes a bigger thing they want to address, but they'll write to a lower rank officer. Again, he'll not be in a position to do it. So there is a need for you as well as the people who get educated by you to know that for what kind of things, where to be approached, so that things can be sorted out. So this is the idea. I hope we're able to put across this point. Again, coming to biotechnology, we are one of the leading state in Karnataka. We are the first state to come with the third version of the biotechnology policy. You know, we are the first state way back in 2001. So to come with the first biotechnology policy, and we again had a second version of the policy in 2009-10. And now we have a biotechnology policy at 2017, which we launched, which we announced. It is valid till 2022, and now, as I told you, we are the first in the country almost to have a first biotechnology policy, and again first in the country to have a third version of the biotechnology policy, and we are again the first state to bring out a bioeconomy report, because bioeconomy is basically the overall. It's not about only technology. How it improves the economy. It can be in marine. It can be in animal husbandry. How the overall involvement of the total economic activity started from biotechnology is what we call bioeconomy in the simple terms. So we come out with that report last year. We launched it. We commissioned a report and we got a report wherein we are talking about. You can see that we are valued around the total bioeconomy of the state is around 22.6 billion. And we are targeting up to 50 billion by 2025. Because 50 billion, why? Because the government of India has targeted around 100 to 150 billion dollars by 2025. So we normally look at around 35 to 40% or 50% range as our contribution, which we want to maintain. So keeping that point of view, we ourselves have targeted to reach 50 billion. And we work in various angles. Now again, coming to 60% of the country's biotech companies are in Karnataka. I know one of the leading sector is biopharma within the biotechnology. And coming to workforce, we have one of the largest workforce in biotech. And you can see that number of engineering, number of biotechnology colleges, number of companies, and all those things gives an idea for you, like why we claim all these things. And again, advantage for us, because we have some biotech clusters which has formed because of the various reasons. Bangalore, because of the research institutes and academic institutes and the government organization which is there. The Mysore, because of the CFTR and other organizations. So what we do is we try to collaborate, or we try to bring all the players into one platform, and they form kind of a collaborative effort. So that's what we call as a biotech cluster. And our focus has been more to develop these clusters in a focused manner. As I told you, academics, my title I mentioned as a leveraging the academic, industry and governmental interaction. You can see how, I'm just listed here the biotechnology or life sciences based central and state institutes. There are many other engineering and non-engineering institute also. It can be Raman Institute of Research, or it can be other organizations. But I listed out only the something relevant to life sciences and biotechnology. You can see we have more than 25 plus central government organizations and state government organizations. So these are all the cradle for the ideas, the cradle for the technology to come out. So from there, this gives a kind of a starting point. Science in Bangalore can happen without Indian of science. Then again, similarly, if we are talking about anything about neurology, the first thing that comes into our mind is NIMHANS. at the same time you want to talk about something about forest or something to do with plywood and other things, or you want to have resources about forest, so you have Institute of Wood Science and Technology. So these are all things which gives a kind of a starting point for you for get a trained manpower. And this trained manpower, when they have some good ideas or brilliant ideas, when they form a company and that grows, so that way the whole ecosystem grows. So as I told you, this is academic which we leverage many times. In a sense, we have lot many experts whom we'll be interacting and we'll be closely working with. And similarly, when we do all these things, you need to have a system. So what we did is we formed what is known as Vision Group on Biotechnology. This is a group where it has academicians, industry people, and subject experts. And the chairperson of this Vision Group for Biotechnology is Dr. Kiran Madan-Dasha. I don't have to tell who it is, but everybody knows. She's the chairman, I mean, executive chairman of the Biocon Limited. And she's been one of the most, very active member who has been in many forums, who has been promoting biotechnology both within the state as well as outside state, even outside country for that matter. So we all meet now and then based on the requirement, and they provide a lot of inputs to us how to plan ourselves and all those things. And in following slides, I'll tell you how the vision statement of this group has led to activities which has now is yielding the results in terms of developing technology or providing the employment. And you can see that we have experts in biotechnology, starting from, you know, Dr. Krishna Ella is part of our vision group. And similarly, we have Vishnu Prasad Alwam, again, who must be hearing about his Candor Technologies. So he is also a part of the group. And we have Professor K. Vijayaraghavan, who is a principal scientific advisor to the Prime Minister's office. So these are the people all we meet, and we take the inputs and chalk out our future plans. And basically, as I told you, policy always has some kind of the roadmap, what we want to do. So after that, we have identified some 6 to 7 pillars segments. So out of that, see, you know, it's a comprehensive policy when you prepare it. So we always look at many ways to bring the ecosystem up. So ease of doing business, policy interventions, because there's many policy interventions, like as I told you, bottlenecks in terms of some old act or old rules and regulations, which will not be applicable now, and you need to come out with some innovative idea. Somebody wants to do innovative ideas, and the old acts or policy will be a deterrent. So there we come with novel ideas and make sure that policy intervention is happening, and they overcome that problems. Similarly, you need to develop skill, because you need to provide trained manpower to the industry, and you need to support startups and entrepreneurship, because this is one of the area where we can help people become employed as well as provide employment. And obviously you have to do R&D for societal based issues. So it can be something like a Casimir forest disease, or it can be something related to some tribal. So we, as a state government, we need to work on those areas also, where it can be something to related with some problem statement coming from probably a sewage or antimicrobial resistance kind of things. So all these things will be addressed, will be part of the whole policy. And you need to leverage, as I told you, the existing other ecosystems. So IT is one of the ecosystems which we are trying to leverage. And you can't stop there. And there are many new technologies going to come up. And what is your plans? How you're going to plan for that? All those things will be part of the whole program. So that's why we consider the policy is a major. Normally, faculty or students don't look into the policies of the state. Normally, they look into just some of the programs and schemes coming up. But policy is the one which you have to understand, because policy is something which what the government has a plan for next five, six years, it'll be mentioned in the policy. So when we draft a policy, we take a lot of inputs from the people. And we have seen many a times that even though when you ask for a feedback, none of the faculty or the students make efforts to reach out to us giving the inputs, because inputs coming from anywhere is important. And now for information, Department of Biotechnology, central government has come out with a new strategy, National Biotechnology Strategy for 2020-2025. And it's a draft is out. You can visit the website, it's available. And they have called for opinion or suggestions from general public as well as subject experts. And many of you who are keen to contribute, who want to know more details, please do visit the Department of Biotechnology website, dbtindia.nikin, and you can look into the policy, strategy, what they have, and you can suggest. And accordingly, you can also plan your activities in the college or in the institutions where you're working, because sometimes we have seen that the state or somebody else is thinking something else and you come with something else. It's not that it should not come out, but if it's something with aligned, so it will be easy for people to accept and implement it. So that's where please look into the thing, and we also have a policy and we can share, and it's available in the public domain also. You can also go through it. And as I told you, we look at biotech clusters. And when you say clusters, we do a lot of studies, interact with people, take opinion from the biotech vision group, and we identify the area where we need to focus. Like, for example, you can see in Mysore, we are focusing, since CFTRA is there, and we have other industries like Hector, you have Nestle, and you have other companies related to food and aspect. So we thought Nutra and Nutraceutical is one area where that particular Mysore city can be clustered upon. Similarly, you can see Bangalore you have everything. So somewhere we have combined that, and we want to make it like a proper biotech, where you have a lot of interaction is there. And similarly, you can see in Mangalore, we are looking at aquamarine as a segment. Hubli, we are looking at Hubli Dharwad, we are looking at agri as a focus area. And in North Bidar, because we are looking at vivarium and animal testing, because there you have a animal husbandry, you have a university there. So keeping that point of view, we as a state plan for something like that, and then focus all our resources and inputs to see that the activity, whatever we do, even though other activities can happen, but the final focus should be something related to this. So what we are trying to do is create what is already happened in Bangalore in other cities, but it is centered around these segments. That is the idea. And people who are, suppose, I don't know how many are from Bangalore and other places, if any faculty are there from these areas or you're native of these areas, please do interact with these people. I mean, we have other. I'll be showing whom we are coordinating with, so you can talk to them and see how you can also contribute to the growth of biotechnology in that particular city. Yeah. So this is the Bangalore. So we had Vision Group. So Vision Group came way back in 2000. They conceptualized what is known as Biotech Park. So this we have in Bangalore Biotech Park, or Bangalore Helix Biotech Park is located in Electronic City. So when we say biotechnology park, it comprises of three zones actually. You have academic zones, you have incubation zone, and you have industry zone. You can see from the picture, we have IBAB, that is Institute for Bioinformatics and Applied Biotechnology. Then you have Center for Human Genetics. These two are academic institutions which is working on advanced area of biotechnology. Be it the genomics, be it the synthetic biology, these kind of areas they are working on. And they provide post-graduation as well as PhD courses. Apart from that, they do research. Primarily, these are the research-focused organizations, but they do have academic programs, like as I said, the MSc in bioinformatics, and they are now recently, they are going to start MSc in big data biology. So this is again supported by both Government of Karnataka and the Government of India. And you can see the red building there, that is the incubation center. So it is around 60,000 square feet of incubation center. It's called as Bangalore Bioinnovation Center. So there are more than 50 startup companies are incubated there. It has almost 30,000 square feet of common instrumentation facility. You have the instrument starting from HPLC to fermenter. Everything is there. No company or nobody wants, no need to set up anything. They don't have to waste their money or spend the money for capital expenditure, buying costly equipment. They can come here, incubate, and then nurture their ideas or validate the ideas. And once successful, they can always go to the market. And just behind the red building, what you can see, little vacant land. Their industry zone is coming up. It's around 52 acres of land. Almost 60 lakh square feet of building is going to come up in those areas. Already construction has started. So it will house almost 150 companies. We are expecting 150 companies to be housed there. And almost 50,000 to 50,000 direct and indirect jobs are generated from this. So you can see how the idea of forming a biotech park way back in 2020s, early 2000s has yielded this kind of efforts. You know, from IBAB and CSG, we have almost so far more than 2,000, 3,000 students have been trained in high-end technology, and they've been working in various industries, starting from both national and international places. So now this way we are looking at. And just to give a individually, I don't go much about individually, it's available in the website. Now, as you can see that these are areas they're working on, very advanced area of biotechnology. And as a faculty, you may not be what you call working in this area, but you can always collaborate with these institutes. And if you need any support, please do contact us. We will try to facilitate for the collaboration. And you can visit them, and you can ask your students also to visit whenever they I mean, as part of the industry visit program. And you can see that we are supporting, you know, apart from regular teaching and research, what we do, we state government also supports to set up some new segment. You can see we have a bio-IT center. We are supporting with a 10 crore grant for the establishing bio-IT to train manpower in the advanced area of genomics. At the same time, we have set up a synthetic group, so which is working on yeast-based technology. I mean, then again, they're working on something. I mean, they're an intern and collaborative industry also, so that synthetic biology, the synthetic biology as a segment. So if somebody is interested to start something, you need to have some base. So we thought this is the best way to do it. And if somebody are working on this area, you can do contact us. We can refer to them. Then. We have, as I told you, incubation center. This incubation center has around 60,000 square feet of area. And right now we have around 45 incubators. And we have various facilities here. And you can also, suppose you want to utilize some of the equipments, people can utilize on pay by use basis. And then as I told you, some of the projects can also be taken up by, you can interact with the startups there, and you can have some kind of collaborative projects also. And this is the industry area, what I told you, where it is going to come up with the 60 lakh square feet of area. So out of the 60 lakh square feet, what you're talking about, 50 lakh square feet, around 60% will be biotech area. The remaining 40% will be for IT and other industries. So you can see how we as a state is trying to build an ecosystem and a kind of global ecosystem. So that we have the target what we set for ourselves of reaching around $50 billion is reached. And this we are talking about South. Again, you know, we have Bangalore's largest city, and you have a lot many institutes. Now, again, you have in North towards airport, the new airport, what we call, we have a lot of cluster organizations. So this we have NCBS, then INSTEM, CCAMP, and GKVK, and you have JNCR, then you have even IAS, which is very close by. So these all become a kind of cluster. You know, biotechnology doesn't work, doesn't grow in isolation, because you need a lot of support system. And it basically, in anywhere in the world, it thrives on the cluster system. Because, you know, expertise required for coming with the solution is not possible on single-handed. You need to collaborate with lot many people. And that's how these kind of clusters are formed. And what we've done again is, as I told you, when we are trying to develop biotechnology in other cities, you need to have some base. And what we have done is we have collaborated with the anchor institute, what we call an anchor organizations in those cities. And we, with their help, we have set up some facility, which by using those facilities, the people can either set up an industry or come or do a project there. And so that part of the area, what we call the cluster formation happens. So as I told you, Mysore is where focused on Utah phytopharmaceuticals, and CFTR is our anchor organization. So we have set up an incubation center, which is around 8,000 square feet of area. And again, they have many instruments which is suitable for this segment. HPLC, LCMS, and all those things are there. And more than that, you have the mentorship and the expertise of the CFTR which can provide you in these areas. And any institutes or any faculty who are interested to work in this area or working in this area, and you're looking for some kind of support, please do contact them, and they'll definitely will be helping you out across. And as I told you, in Dharwad, Hubli Dharwad is basically agrarian area, and we thought it's a best place to look at giving impetus to the agri biotechnology area. So again, where we have incubation center with some kind of common facility, common instrumentation facilities, and you have the, we are tied up with, as you know, you can US University of Agricultural Sciences, Dharwad. So you have the, already have a, what you call kind of knowledge and the infrastructure, and the people nearby or people who want to work in this area, they can utilize this facility and they can utilize the facility to go forward. And again, you can see that we have University of Horticultural Sciences in Bagalkot, and they are basically working on cash crops. And we thought it is very important for us to support some kind of activity in those areas also. So that's why we have supported the establishment of Center for Biotechnology Research and its incubation center also. And there, the primary focus of the institute there is to work on cash crops like pomegranate, tomato, banana, and they're even working on Garcinia, identifying to see whether high yielding lines of Garcinia. You know, Garcinia extract being is export market. It's basically used for weight loss, and they want to see whether high yielding lines can be developed, because basically it's a forestry and nobody cultivates it. And you need to first conserve the germplasm, collect the germplasm from various resources, various places, and see which one yields the highest yield of minus hydroxycitric acid and other active principles. And based on that, they will, when somebody has to make it a cash crop, somebody has to work in a basic work. So we are trying to see whether by our support that can happen. In future years, we can have some new cash crops coming up, especially in the area of immunotoxicals, or maybe in something leading to even probably in therapeutics also. Yeah, that's all related to more of a capacity building or what you say infrastructure kind of things. But again, you need to have some capacity building access activity undertaken at institute level also, at academic level. So what we have done is we have another policy called Karnataka Startup Policy. You must be knowing about it. If you're not sure, this is a policy wherein we say what we intend to do to promote startups in the state of Karnataka. And the target here is to support or to develop around 20,000 technology-based startups. Okay, you know, it's not about just starting a new company. So it's see, you know, now it's a knowledge is, they say knowledge is very important, and it's all knowledge-based industry, and data is oil. So if all the things we are talking about, we need to talk about technology. So we are here to promote formation of around 20,000 technology-based startups. And out of the 6,000 should be something manufacturing, product-based, because, you know, just giving services is not enough. Any company can create wealth only if they have a product or unique product to sell. So keeping that point of view, we have targeted also 6,000 product-based startups. And this definitely will generate employment, but again, you can see it will generate around 6 lakh direct or indirect employment, almost, you know, 12 lakh. So all this is we are trying to do, see that the whole ecosystem grows. That is the basic idea. And what we've done is in this, as a capacity building measure, we have come into a program called New Education Incubation Network. This is an incubation of center established in academic institutes like engineering colleges outside Bangalore, not within Bangalore, because the idea is to make sure that the benefit reaches to the outside the Bangalore area and more who require. So we have formed 30 institutions are there. The thing is, like here it is, no, we provide 10 lakh rupees for an incubator to set up every year. then we provide 3 lakh rupees for a project, student project, which is commercializable. Up to 10 projects we sanction for each of the institution. So you can see that if a postgraduate or postgraduate in the institute has a brilliant idea of which is commercially possible. Now that's where we are supporting. So that idea should not die, and that idea should not go off because we are not able to work on it, or because we are not able to validate it. So we are providing this program, and this program is there in 30 institutions spread all over Karnataka. And so far, you can see that we have spent almost 443 lakhs, almost 4.4 crore rupees on this. Especially, this is only on the projects. And out of this, I'm happy to say that we have many patents coming up, and few companies have formed. And the companies in turn have also generated money in terms of grants and other things, funding. So similarly, when we thought, many times you can establish the incubation center in institutes, but the problem is sometimes these, where the exact, the people who require and the institute is slightly far off. So keeping that point of view, what we thought is we identified, we established a common instrumentation facility with more of engineering facility like lathe and 3D printer and all those things in a centralized place wherein it can be accessible to all the people. It's not about academic people. It is general, even for example, even machinery. A manufacturing company wants to utilize some facility, they can come here and utilize it. So we have five common instrumentation facility in Bangalore. Bangalore, it is there in Jalali Metro. As I told you, we want to establish in a very centralized place. So in Bangalore, it is there in Jalali Metro station, in the metro station itself. So if any of you are keen to utilize the facility, please do visit there. And you have a lot of good equipments there also, which can be used for designing basically. That is one. And you have a lot many institutes, reputed institutes. They have a lot many patent or knowledge generated, but they don't know how to commercialize, how to go about commercializing it. So we came with the program of technology business incubators. So basically idea is there to translate whatever patent and other knowledge is there to kind of a commercial activity. So for that, we have this program, Technology Business Incubator. The Institute of Higher Education should have around 5,000 square feet of incubation area. And obviously they need to have some patents and other things, and obviously the subject knowledge, so which can make them guide or mentor some of the new startups and the students themselves to become entrepreneurs, based on the knowledge or the patent what they have. And right now we have five technology incubators. Two out of them are relevant to biotechnology. One we have in Manipal, Manipal Academy for Higher Education. It's a Manipal GOK bio incubator, what we call. The focus area there is biopharma, medtech, and biomedical. And we have agri-based focused incubator in CCAM, in collaboration with the University of Agriculture Sciences, Bangalore. Here, the idea is that when we say it's there in higher education, it not be others. It's open for others also. It's not that it's only for those institutes. Other people can also utilize it. So we have seen, Udupi and Bangalore, they are doing very well in terms of, because a lot many incubators are supported here. And they do regular hackathons, talks, seminars. So you can visit the website and you can subscribe to them, and you can get regular touch with them. And if you want more information, please do write to us, and definitely we'll provide and connect to the concerned person, because this is very important for you, because as a faculty or teacher, you need to show career path to students. So these are the ways and means where they can utilize the existing facility and plan for themselves. See, otherwise what happens, unless we tell them what is the paths, it's very difficult for them to understand and plan themselves. So keeping that point of view, I'm giving this outlook. This is a picture of that, what we have, technology business incubator. You can see that apart from this, We have centers of excellence. You can see that we have around eight or nine centers of excellence we have here, and all are focused. You can see none of these areas in any other state or in other thing places you will hear much about it. We are putting a lot of efforts. We are putting a lot of our resources to have these centers, so that in future when the technology gets adapted by the industry or adapted by the people, so there should be some institute which can handle or which can provide that kind of, I mean, what you call facility for people to, I mean, new ideas. If any new ideas is that there should be a place for people to go and validate themselves or scale up. All those things have to do. So we have this center of excellence, various scientific emerging areas. And out of that, the one which I want to focus is the purple one, that is the Center for Excellence in Agri Innovation. You know, we have a lot many problems in agriculture. So starting from pre-harvesting to post-harvesting, then marketing, every segment you can innovate, you can come with some innovative ideas. So, but the existing system sometimes will not allow you. So you need to come with out-of-box kind of thinking to solve some of the problems. So what we thought is we have a center of excellence in agri innovation, primarily focusing on removing the pain points that is seen in the agriculture, so that when we throw as a grand challenge, when we identify pain points, then we know what exactly we're talking about. When we show the problem statement, and we can get a lot many innovative ideas from the both academic, general public, or maybe even students also for that matter, and that can be nurtured into a product, world-class product. That is the whole idea here. And very soon we'll be announcing grand challenge on agriculture. Please look into papers and our websites and other things. If somebody of you can want to participate, please do participate. Apart from that, you are all from some of your engineering colleges. You have other disciplines, departments. So you can also apprise them of this facility, what is available. So can you imagine we have a center of excellence for animation, gaming, and what you call visual effects. We are one of the best, facility in AVGC, what we call. The experts who are there are from people who have supported, production of film like Bahubali and other films which are used this AVGC technologies. So you may be wondering why AVGC is related to me, why I should bother about. Now, when you're talking about you want to do virtual some studies. So you have to create a virtual specimen kind of things. So these are the people where we can collaborate. And when we arrange a meeting of some of the biotechnology colleges heads to the ABGC, the idea came is that why don't we collaborate with this technology? That is animation gaming people and have a mouse, virtual mouse, which can be used for clinical trials. So that is the idea that is going to come up. So now something like that can have come up, and probably you can whole body can be scanned, and that can be used for having some kind of suppose somebody is creating some kind of outfit, so they can use this facility. So all these things are there. The range is too much, and it's all left to you. That's where we say that if you have a new idea, something like that, we are here to provide the facility for you to validate it. And just to give an overall what I've given here, so we are in all the places, because as a welfare state, we need to reach out to a lot many people. So we are there almost in all districts. So if enough you're from these districts and you want to know more about what we are doing in your particular districts, please do write to us, and we'll provide you all the details to you. Yeah, this is coming to industry. As our department, we are working on, because our department is a very small department compared to other departments like agriculture or revenue or commerce and industry. So we work in a very niche area of technology, but our other departments are working in a larger scale. In terms of biotechnology related aspect, we have industrial area in Bangalore, in Mangalore, and even Yadgir. We have a pharmaceutical pharma SEZ and pharma industrial area is there. It's very close to Hyderabad area, and we want to, we know a lot many Hyderabad based or other industries would like to have a facility in Karnataka, because of the various incentives and promotion concessions to what we give. So keeping that point of view, we have identified Yadgir as a place for pharma. And again, Hassan, again, is a good place for establishing a large-scale scale-up industry. And, you know, Mangalore again is a area where any industry which is having a lot of export potential and it need to have a port and other things nearby. So Mangalore can be a good area. So these are the industry area. Already you can see Mangalore, Syngene is there, and few of the aromatic chemical companies are already located in this industrial area. And similarly in pharma, we have starting from Aurobindo to Micro Labs, they are going to set up factories there. And these are the places where you need to, where you can tell you some of your students to look into a futuristic, more job-wise, as well as for becoming entrepreneur. And what I spoke all about infrastructure. So we have some funding opportunities. We have funding opportunity in terms for promoting entrepreneurship as well as ideas. The first one, what major one, what we have is idea to POC, that is idea to proof of concept. So here we give up to 50 lakh rupees for any particular idea. We have selection process there. So where you need to pitch up to a jury or jury of experts and they will recommend it. So we give up to 50 lakh rupees to a startup to nurture their idea or validate the idea, develop the idea to whatever proof of concept they have into a pilot or into working model. It's a sector agnostic. So we have funded all sectors. We have told so far, we have funded around 489, almost worth around 116 crore worth of rupees altogether. Out of that, almost 75% funds has been already released to them. And among them, around 35 to 40% are from biotech area, biotech, agri-tech, then health tech. These are the areas you have startups. So you can see how much the ideas that we are supporting. At the same time, some of them get succeeded. So job or revenue that come out from this. It's not only about commercial ideas, it's about social impact relevant also. We have what is known as grand challenges. This again, we go by the what is societal problems. So it can be related to transport, it can be related to sewage water, it can be solid waste management, it can be related to water management, or it can be related to agriculture, pest related. So anything which we think as a state we need to solve, or as a group something has to be solved. So we throw a challenge. So this happens at two levels. The first level, we select a project and sanction 10 lakh rupees for them. Around 5 to 6 projects in each problem statement will be providing. Out of the 5 to 6 problem statement, whoever comes with a very good model or a very good result, so we further support them with another 50 lakh rupees for them to scale up. Now very soon we'll be coming out with grand challenges in the area of urban development and transport most probably. So look forward for keep looking in our websites and other places for other challenges. And as I told you, we are going to come up with soon agriculture also, more related to soil health, sensor based maintaining soil health and other things which can help the farmers to maintain grow healthy crops. That is the idea. And apart from this, your industry also, see, after you scale up, for scaling up or you want to go to market in a bigger scale, you need a lot of funds in grows together. And biotechnology is one of the area where it's very difficult to get a venture capitalist to fund. So what we have done is, as a state, we have formed a 50 crores fund, what is known as Bio Venture Fund. So we fund from around 2.5 crores to 4 crores to 4.5 crores to companies who have a scale-up kind of technology and they want to go for a market, a bigger market, what you say. You can see that we have funded Pandorum Technology. This is a company which is working on artificial cornea and based on regenerative tissue technology. Then String Bio is working on methane-based products from synthetic biology route. And Biprogen basically is a clinical research organization in Mysore. And Jiva Life Sciences is a very promising startup which is working on what you call sex separation of bovine or cow's sperm, so that we can have more milk producing calf produce. So now these are the technologies which has to be supported, because it's not easy to get funding for these kind of projects. So that's why we have come across this project. And when you do all those things, you know, when you start a company and something happens, and they need a lot of mentorship, because biotechnology is not about this technology. You need to have a lot of regulatory compliances. You need to talk to about, because regulatory compliances changes from country to country. And for product to product, you need to have a different plan to implement it. So keeping all that in view, again, we have a mentorship program, which is a 1 year program. We have this. This is called Karnataka Startup Advancement Program. So under this program, we are going to handhold 50 startups to success, wherein we are going to bring a lot of expertise or experts to nurture them, to guide them at every level, starting from product development to into market, to bringing it to the market level. Why we are doing all these things? See, these are not doing just like that. This is all coming from the feedback, what we get from the people. Sir, I started my company, or I don't know how to go about, I'm finding very difficult, I don't know whom to approach. Then somebody will say, sir, I have a good idea, but I don't know how to get the funds. Where to get the funds, but I just need a small money. I don't want close together. I just want something like 15 lakh rupees just to, I just try to find out whether my idea is good or not. So these are the programs which is going to help for those kind of people. And this way, as a faculty, you need to, encourage your students to nurture their idea, or make sure that their idea, try to work it on that. And a lot of funding opportunities are there, unlike earlier times. So you have both private as well as government. So this is one of the things what we're doing in terms of supporting the whole ecosystem. And again, many of you must be knowing already. So we have it's not about just infrastructure. It's not about just funds. It's about human resources, or what you call as human capital also. So we have, especially for biotechnology, we have a skilling program for other IT also. But since the forum is for biotechnology, I just restrict myself to biotechnology. So we have a biotechnology skill enhancement program. This is basically biotechnology finishing school, which we started way back in 2011, when the Vision Group suggested that the people coming from the academics are not properly industrially trained. It is not that they're not, subject wise they're very strong. Theoretically, they're very strong. But in terms of practicality, the industry felt the people, the students coming out of the academic, are not able to provide the kind of services that they wanted. So what we did is we tied up with industry organizations like ABLE, Association for Biotech Enterprises. Then we had with LSSDC, that is Life Science Sector, for skill development, know those people. And the second program is supported by Department of Biotechnology. You can see that these are the students who have been trained in the 2000, almost in the BTFS. You can see some of the students have gone to many places. You can see students, some of them are working overseas, some of them have become entrepreneurs, and some of them are now who started a career in the executive level, small and lower rank. Or now we have gone to middle level management, and by this program we intend to see in later years some CTOs being some BICEP students or BTFS students becoming CTOs of the companies also. And now we are expanding this under Department of Biotechnology support. We are expanding this skilling to other aspects also. So we are going to, because we already identified partner institutes with support from Department of Biotechnology for doing refresher course and faculty development program. So we are focusing on some niche areas. The institutes whom we have identified are Mangalore University. Then we have National Institute for Animal Nutrition and Physiology in Madiwala. And we have four institutes are there, which are going to provide this faculty training program in the area of life science and biotechnology. So we'll be notifying very soon, and interested people can participate. And we have entrepreneurship program more focused on agriculture. It can be goat rearing, it can be mushroom cultivation or floriculture ventures. So we are going to have, especially we have in Vijaipura training, and we are going to have in Mysore, in sericulture. So these are all the programs we are going to come out very soon. Please look into the papers and our websites and other social media handles for more information. And obviously, biotechnology finishing school program is there, which we have been running this program for last almost 10 years now. But because of the COVID, this year we didn't take a batch. But what we did is we did a 3 months online course with the same syllabus. And for a select few, we are providing them hands-on training after the 3 months program. And provided the COVID-19 situation passes off, and we have a control over it, and we hope to have a full-scale one-year program. This program, you know, as you know, most of you know, but just for the sake of information, this is a one-year program where 6 months academic training will be provided to the students in a particular high-end segment of biotechnology. It can be fermentation biotechnology, nutraceuticals and food processing, or bioinformatics and big data analytics. It can be in molecular and cellular diagnostics, cellular and molecular diagnostics, and protein expression scale-up. These are very high-end, industry-oriented domains, and we provide focused training to the students and hands-on, with a lot of hands-on experience. And followed by 6 months academic training, they'll be compulsorily put into industry internship for 6 months. It's a mandatory internship. And for a whole period of 1 year, the students will be getting a fellowship amount of around 10,000 rupees every month. So now the advantage here is that the students, after getting trained hands-on in a particular domain, and they place in the industry of particular segment, particular domain industry, they're able to contribute to the growth of the company much earlier than what normally they do, because otherwise they have to learn that everything and then contribute it. Now, since they are already trained in certain areas, and the moment they go there, they're able to contribute. And in the process, what happens, the companies also feel very, very happy to have them, and they're offering job also. So in the process, what happens, the placement percentage is slightly, much better. It's around 70 to 80% placement we have, where balance 10%, 20% is basically the students want to go to higher studies. And some of them leave in between because they have other career to take it up. But what I'm trying to tell across is these kind of programs can be adopted by the faculty at your end. So you can also have something similar program probably with your own funding if possible, or you can tie up with the industry also who may be ready to fund you. To have, if not 1 year program, you can plan a 6 month program or 3 months program, wherein students are exposed both to industry and academic in a particular area. Because see, you need to go to the industry and ask them what is the requirement. So based on the requirement, if you can back work and train the students, that'll be much better. I know in the academic setup, when you have a fixed syllabus and all those things, it's very difficult to have what you call flexibility in the syllabus. But few are autonomous institutes or universities. Now, if you have the flexibility, please adapt some of these programs. What we do, this is all time tested, and this has been conceptualized by experts, and we are able to see a marked difference in the overall growth of the students who have been trained, and the faculty who have been exposed to these kind of systems. When they try to implement at their level, there's a marked difference between the way they to teach earlier and they teach now. So I would suggest you to, website is there. You can visit us, as I told you, I'll give the details, more details. And you can interact with some of these coordinators, and you can use the facility also, because we have provided funding up to 1 crore rupees for to set up the facility, equipment and other things. And colleges nearby can go to these colleges and utilize the facility also. And we can facilitate that if you want to have, if you have any issues there. Okay. And coming to industry, the segments, what we have. So we have many companies working in a lot many areas of biotechnology, starting from biopharma to bio-IT, to synthetic biology and emerging areas, genomics. So we have every segment of biotechnology companies in Karnataka. So that has been the very, that's making us the whole system ecosystem thrive and have a lot of collaboration. And you can see that it starts from small companies where engineering companies, students who have started a company. For example, you can see we have Creagen, which is working on agriculture, Sami Labs, which is working on nutraceuticals and bioactives. Then Pandorum, I told you, which is emerging, which is working on emerging areas. Then you can see Medgenome, which is one of the good company, which is working on human genomics and then sequencing the whole genome of both targeted at rare diseases as well as other diseases part of it. And they have a huge collaboration also. And again, you can see one of the oldest companies, Meta Natural Remedies, which is working in animal nutrition area and animal health area. And Metalix, you must be knowing, it has been acquired by Rallis and they are nurturing it. So these kind of companies are there. And Stemputics again, which is working on stem cell based technologies. So we have a lot many companies in Karnataka. We are lucky to have these kind of companies in Karnataka. And for that industry, I won't talk much about this because this is more to industry oriented, but to support industry, we have a lot of schemes which is suitable for them. So like providing capital subsidy, then some kind of power tariff, because you know biotechnology needs a lot of lab space, a lot of power is drawn, energy is drawn. So we provide them some power tariff concession, and they need to file patents and other things. So we provide some patent reimbursement. This for all for companies, not for academic institutes. But I just want to tell you this because somebody wants to avail the facility, probably you can convey the message to them. Again, as I told you, being a progressive state and when you're talking about technology, a lot of technologies come out, and there are instances where the technology is not, you cannot implement in the ground level because the existing laws prevent it or it becomes a deterrent. And to overcome that, you need some kind of flexibility. So by normal means of passing bill and discussion, all these things is going to take a lot of time. So what we noticed, we have come up with is what is known as Karnataka Innovation. So this is an authority which, like, you must have seen Bangalore Development Authority. Like, this is an authority, so like it's a constitutional body, state government formed body, where Chief Minister is the chairman of this this authority. So anybody who has a disruptive technology and they think that existing laws or existing rules and regulations are becoming difficult and they're not able to scale it up, and they want to make sure that these laws are taken out, so they can apply, and this authority can with some kind of conditions, they can waive off the whole law for 6 to 1 year period. So during this period, the company or the people who can take have the idea can pilot it, validate it, see whether what is the pros and cons of the technology what they have developed, and see whether it can be adapted at a larger scale, and there's no problem in any kind of problems for any kind of segment, any segment, or we can adapt to the technology without any hazard. So that is possible under now under this authority. So many of you will not be knowing because most of the people, they start working on the technology without looking at the existing laws and other things. Because if, for example, we have GM crops, I know it's a very contentious issue, but you have a difference of opinion at the government level as well as at the field level. So now if you want to start working on it, sometimes you do a lot of work and in the end of the day, you finally feel that the system is not ready to accept it. So instead of that, you can understand all these, what the rules and regulations are there to some extent, and then start working on it. Then probably if you have some irritant or some deterrence are there, that can be overcome. So this is one way of the state trying to be ahead of the times. We have come out with this novel authority. This is one thing. And you know, we cannot work in isolation. It's now we are a global citizens now, they say, and we need to work with lot many, you know, ecosystems and people. And so what we've done is, we are the top 20 global innovation ecosystem in the world. And what we've done is we are collaborating with other top 20 global innovations system, hubs. And based on the requirement, we are working with different subjects. So, for example, from Israel, we are working on agri-tech related aspect. Sorry. Netherlands, we are talking to agri-related aspect. Taiwan, we are talking about electronics related aspects. And Australia, we're talking about marine and then artificial intelligence and all those things. So based on the inherent strength of these ecosystems, so we are talking with them, collaborating with them, having a joint projects, and they are involved in our activities. Whatever the plans we do, we take the opinion and we get the inputs. We have close interaction and we facilitate people-to-people contact, but in terms of supporting some of the faculty and students to go to their place and have the exchange. This all we do it. And again, when you do all these things, you need one big platform to bring all the stakeholders into one place. So that platform, what we have is Bangalore Tech Summit. So Bangalore Tech Summit is a sector agnostic, but we have two separate tracks will be there for electronics, IT, BT, all will be there. It will be usually a 3-day events. And I mean, we have everything. I mean, we are all for all stakeholders, starting from students to faculty to industry, startups, academicians, NGOs. Everybody, they'll be in one platform. So you can keep in mind. So this year again, it'll be happening in November. So if any of you are interested, please do join. So we have poster sessions, a quiz, all those things are there, and more activities will be also be planned. Yeah, as I told you, what we are looking at future of biotechnology in the state, just to a glimpse, like now, you know, we already now 20 years of our journey in the state for biotechnology, because, you know, biotechnology as a state supported subject started way back in 1999-2000. And it was 20 years later, we thought we need to know what exactly we need to do in future. So keeping in alignment with the central government's or central government target. So what we did is we commissioned a study recently, very recently, called Bioeconomy Report. And the Bioeconomy Report has come out with details like, you know, the state is, the bioeconomy contribution of the state is around 22.6 billion, which is nearly 9.3% of the state economic output, the total economic output. Okay, so now, now again, when you want to focus, what will be the future focus areas? So we have been, so far we have been doing many things. So we need to focus ourselves in some areas which is going to give an advantage for us in the coming years. So what we have done is we have identified these areas, like which you can see on your panel, I mean the screen, the vaccine, because which, you know, very important, because vaccine, though we have that lot many companies working on these areas in terms of R&D and other things, but we don't have any manufacturing base. In my neighboring states like Telangana, Andhra, and Maharashtra, they have some other base, which you must be knowing by this time. And we want to support this. And at the same time, we want to work on the next generation of vaccines, be it DNA based or vector based, those kind of vaccines, next generation vaccines, because that's where we thought we can make a difference. And again, biomanufacturing, because biomanufacturing, basically what happens now, it's all spread across in different places. So we want to provide some kind of a facility for all the manufacturing companies to come in one place and then set up their industry. And in the process, job employment generation also happens, and collaboration with local academic people also happen. Then again, BT crops, but again, this is a contentious issue, but we are working on this to see how we can convince both farmers as well as other people to see how they can accept this. And now with the new technology like gene editing and other coming up, so probably we'll have more interaction or a discussion about these kind of technologies, how it can be adapted by us. And as I told you, marine biotech is one of the focus area. So we are trying to see whether we can support in coastal areas, especially related to mariculture and seaweed culture, because these two are very very promising areas under the marine biotechnology. It has a very huge potential, both in terms of job generation, wealth creation, all those things. And I don't know how many of you are from coastal area, and I know a few of them will have a native there. So if you are, please do write to us. We see how best we can help you out. And the central government also has come with a lot many programs on this. They have what is known as Prime Minister Matsya Sampada Yojana. And we are also collaborating with them for this implementation of this. And basically, this idea is through these programs to bring a kind of what we see in a milk white revolution. We want to bring a blue revolution in this segment. And this has a very potential area for growth, both in terms of providing food to the global level. I mean, because we have a lot much varied bioresources, we have huge resources, bioresources which we can tap. So many of your students want to take up a career. Please encourage them to take up in these areas so that they can utilize the whatever facilities are being provided in terms of the policy and policy interventions. At the same time, we are looking at biorefineries because basically, you know, we have rich in sugarcane growing areas like Mysore and North Karnataka, and biofuel and alternative fuel is one of the area which has been the focus of both state and central government. And with the production of bioethanol, the increased need for combining or mixing with regular petrol and regular fuels to minimize our import expenditure. So we are working on this area also, and we'll be coming out soon with some learning programs. And agri-tech. Agri-tech is, you know, you must have seen in papers, and not many, if you have not gone, if you have no chance to see, please do look into. Agri-tech is seen as one of the most potential area to bring a radical change in the way we look at agriculture by adapting newer technologies. So as I told you, both at the seed level, at growing level, pre-harvest, harvest, post-harvest. So all the segments needs some kind of technology. And we need to come with a technology which is very close, which is adaptable at the ground level, because it should not be something which we get from others and then we're not able to replicate here or implement it. So there's a way, there's definitely a very huge challenge for the experts in this area and other areas to come together and help our agriculture to grow the way we want it, or double the income of the farmer. And what we're targeting basically is to reach around $50 billion by economy by 2025. So I hope all of you contribute in one way or the other, whatever small way is possible. And we are here to discuss with you exchange of ideas. And we are open for it. And whatever support you want, to implement some of the programs and schemes you want. Suppose we don't have, we do facilitate to the next possible ones. Please do contact. This is a small, this lecture is more about not technical. It's giving a overall perspective for you, what you can look forward from the state, from the center, and from the global perspective. And position yourself where you want to make yourself or make your students to reach. That is the basic idea of this program. I thank you. I thank all of you and the organizers for giving this opportunity to talk to you. It's my pleasure. And if you have any specific queries, other things, I'm happy to answer. Otherwise, also, you can write to us whenever you feel like you want to know more about us, and we'll provide the details to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Participants, if you have any queries, please post it in the chat box. Sir, we have a query from one of the participants. Are there any policies in Karnataka that promote stronger ties between industry and universities in R&D?
Yeah, so we do have, when we say grand challenge, that is one where both industry and academy can come together and propose the grand challenge solutions for it. And secondly, when we are talking about BioVenture Fund, So there also you can collaborate with the industry. But right now the academic support has been provided more with our sister organization BGST, which you know most of you must be knowing, the science and technology section of our department. So see here, what we are trying to do is there are many DBT Department of Biotechnology based projects. So we are coordinating some of them in terms of bringing people together. For example, right now you have two programs, one is PACE and one more program is there, where they are looking at academic industry collaborations. And earlier you had right now this program is there, and anything else is there, we can update you. Right now, see, our department bandwidth in terms of supporting huge projects is very limited. So what we're trying to do is basically to ignite some of the aspects of this so that you can go to a bigger scale and seek funds from other agencies and probably generate in terms of CSR and other aspects also. Right now, you can look at grand challenges is the one which can bring both academy and startup together. And in terms of projects, I suggest you to please go to DBT website. And you have two programs running right now, DBT and BIRAC, which is academic industry oriented one. If any of you want to identify any industry for collaboration, please do write to us so we can facilitate for some collaboration.
Is there any possibility to share the problems or the areas where the industries are looking for some solution to the academicians so that we can concentrate on those problems and can work out the solution for it, so that will become easy for, you know, financial assistance from the funding agency?
Yeah, that's true. I mean, it's a very good question actually, because we also have been trying to talk to people, especially industry people, to come with a problem statement, what they think is very important for academic people to take it up. There have been some kind of efforts is happening, talking to them. But what happens now, it's not about just coming with a problem statement or identifying a problem. It is, you need to work with closely with the industry also. There have been a lot of efforts is going on, but somehow it is not happening. What my suggestion is, this is happening informally, though it is not happening formally by in form of some platform, whether it's website or something like that. But there are many problems are being posted, when especially some of the multinationals recently, BSL is an Australian based company, which is more into human blood products. So they had come out with a what you call problem statement, which they want to collaborate to academia and then do it. Okay, but that kind of things are not happening in India, because most of the Indian companies are not into development of products. They're more into manufacturing and production. So you can't expect Indian companies to come up. But my suggestion is, when, for example, Johnson & Johnson and other organizations are coming with problem statement, they're getting the ideas from academic people also. But as I told you, it's not happening in concerting efforts together, but in bits and pieces it's happening. So we tried actually. We have, you can see, if you can see our policy, we are trying to come with what is known as idea cell. The idea cell basically was meant like, you know, we get suggestions from industry and then post it in one place, and people who are interested to solve the problem, they can solve it. The problem came with the IP part of it, but when they post in a public domain the problems and who's how we are going to handle it, so all these problems came, and so somehow we couldn't take it across because industry was not forthcoming, because you know what happens, they like to work in a very close close related or make close collaborative organizations. So making public is slightly difficult. For that, what my suggestion is to please identify the industry which you want to collaborate. Keep some kind of engagement going on with them, either in terms of your visit or their visit or teaching or something like that. So in the process, you can get some details from them. And if you think that you need our support in any manner, we can work on that. But I know this is a good question, but difficult to implement as of now.
As you rightly pointed out, when it comes to a bigger industry, they will go work in a closed environment. But when it comes to startups, who are in getting incubated under your sector, if these people can open up, it will become easy for the academic, because academic, what happens, we have manpower. We have very good dedicated faculty and students who are working for their phase one, phase two and the final projects. And they'll be interested to solve the real-time problem. Unfortunately, many of us will not be knowing what exactly are where exactly to work, right? So under such conditions, if these startups can share their ideas or this thing, so we can solve them and we can help them into groom their idea in a better shape. And the students, other students, they will also get their real-time exposure. And these startups also can visit us and they can make use of the infrastructure available with us. So in that way, we can collaborate. And you people can become a, platform for it.
Yeah. That's true. Multiple services can be possible. As I told you, there's no one single platform to do it. But we probably can take it up at some individual levels or institutional level. And we can try to reach out to that. And we have a good number of startups who want your support, especially academic support, specifically in terms of doing some of the routine testing and other things. So that can be taken up. Then later on, the students, when they pass out, probably they can go as an employee to the startup itself, so they can carry forward the projects what has taken up. That'd be a good idea. As I told you, this is happening at more at individual faculty level or to some extent some kind of institution level. But we can also try. That's where we have found this TBIs and incubation centers in academic institutes, so that that can happen. As I told you, you can in turn collaborate with these TBIs, and we can facilitate that, and that way you can take our help.
Definitely. And I think your session was brainstorming and highly informative, which is very much required for all the faculties who are working in academic institution. And my humble request in you is that since we are running the FDP in three phases, and each phase will have a fresh batch of faculties, I request you to take up one session in each phase. So that all the faculties will be exposed to the infrastructure, facilities and the happenings in and around Bangalore, so that they will take very good message back to their institution. Thank you. Accept our this thing and be a part of us.
Yeah, it's my pleasure, because we also want to reach out to people. Actually, we struggle actually. I've been telling faculty, I don't know whether people are aware. If you post your publications in Twitter or Facebook or LinkedIn, the citation goes up to 50% higher. Okay. And similarly, when you publish something in the public domain, you keep informed. So tomorrow, you don't know who is coming to you and ask for your suggestion. You may be a collaborator. So who knows? So tomorrow, if you have some good publications posted in some of the medias, so you may have some agriculture farmer, somebody coming, okay, sir, I want to collaborate with you. All those things is possible. But I request all of you to please follow our social media handles. And I'm very happy to be part of this whole program, because we want to reach out to people. That's our ultimate goal. So if you can provide a platform, we are very, very, very happy and collaborate. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir, for that information. We are concluding the session for today. So on behalf of the staff, students and management of the Oxford College of Engineering, I deem it a pleasure to thank Dr. Balasubramanian for being our guest speaker for today and gracing this occasion and making all the faculty aware of all the things that are available at the government level so that they can make full use of it. So thank you so much for being part of this session. Thank you, sir.